The movement towards a forest positive future is gaining momentum. Attitudes and behaviors are changing. Changing consumer demands, and forward-thinking producers and suppliers are taking heed and collective action by implementing sustainability processes and standards. It will take all of us, producers, supply chain companies, local and national governments, finance institutions, civil society and NGOs, indigenous people and communities, foresters and farmers, to join in this dialogue to see the results. Research has now proven that trees themselves collaborate. They communicate, share resources, and even forge alliances, becoming a robust force of collective action. We need you to become a part of the solution. Join in the conversations and collective action that will lead to real, transformative change.
Good morning and good afternoon, good evening, everybody. It's my great pleasure to welcome you to this update on the forest agriculture commodity trade dialogues for the COP26 campaign hosted by the UK. My name is Justin Adams. I am the Executive Director of the Tropical Forest Alliance, and it's our great pleasure to be hosting this discussion today. And we have a really exciting action-packed 90 minutes coming up. You can see the agenda up on the screen, but we will be hearing shortly from the UK government about the government process that is at the heart of this FACT dialogue and really at the center of kind of what the UK is trying to achieve as a presidency. We will then be going in to three areas in particular that where we hear some panel discussions, firstly on transparency traceability, then on a new innovation challenge that we're launching today with the World Economic Forum, then smallholders, the criticality of the producers that produce so much of the food we all depend on. And then we'll be moving to sort of a close where we talk about really what some of the asks for business are that are starting to crystallize around the broader forest and commodity agenda, and then into a close. So that's what we're going to be covering. As I say, we'll be running through till 3:30 Europe time. I'm not going to translate that to where everybody is dialing in from, but we will be encouraging you to use the Q&A function, the question and answer function that you can see at the bottom of your Zoom screen, for questions, whether they're questions for individuals or questions for the broader team. We'll try and answer as many of those as possible during the call. The chat function is disabled for the participants. So please use the Q&A during the Zoom call. There will also be Spanish-English translation available Certainly one of our speakers will be speaking in Spanish a little later in the call. So if you want the interpretation, again, you can see that on the toolbar at the bottom of the Zoom screen and just click English. Or if you are joining and would prefer to be listening in Spanish, you can also listen along in Spanish. So that's some of the basic housekeeping for this. I'm sure everybody is well aware of the functionality of our virtual reality now. So let's get underway and move into the discussion and really set the scene for what FACT is. And you know, this is not a new agenda. This is an agenda that many organizations, many of you on this call, have been working on for a decade, two decades and more in some cases. This is the interface between forests, the critical life support system of the planet, and food production, commodity production, which has driven so much of the deforestation that we've seen, and how we bring these agendas together and how we bring the governments that play such an important role in guiding land use and agriculture policy in countries all around the world, then businesses and civil society, all of whom are working on or touching this agenda in different ways. And so the UK has set up this FACT process. We talked about that at an event in December that the TFA hosted, and the UK itself launched had a major major launch that you can still see on YouTube. But this is also really important to say that what today's event is part of the multi-stakeholder track. So the UK, as the government, is leading a government track, which is bringing together these different governments from around the world to discuss the issues. Really important discussions and really important progress being made that we'll move to in a moment. And then the TFA is helping to bring together the rest of the multi-stakeholders, the businesses, the academics, the civil society partners, the community partners, including Indigenous organizations and Indigenous groups, to really input into this process. What's it going to take for us to make progress in this critical decade of action that we are now in? And so this is an update for everybody to understand some of what's happening and really to encourage more people to get involved. And you'll see as we go along different ways that you can get involved in this dialogue, in this discussion, input to and input to that going forward. So that's really where we are today, is hearing lots of voices, hearing what's happening. And without further ado, I want to turn to Simon Sharp, who is the Deputy Director for Policy Campaigns in the COP26 unit, part of the Cabinet Office that's putting on the all-important climate talks in November. Simon, without further ado, across to you to really lay out what you're trying to achieve with the FACT dialogues, where we are, and some of what you're excited about. I'm just getting a message that Simon's had a couple of problems to join the call. And so he's still trying to get on. So maybe if Simon can't join us now, can we move directly into the first panel discussion, and then we'll come back and hear the government update. So apologies for that. What Simon, just to set a tiny bit of context that Simon would have laid out, is that the governments are talking now in four work group areas. There's 28 governments that have signed up to the FACT dialogue from both the forest countries in Latin America, Africa, and Asia, as well as then key countries from consumer countries across Europe, Asia, so Japan, Korea, part of the talks, and the United States, and so a genuine North-South partnership that's working together. And then they have these four work groups, one on trade and market access, one on transparency and traceability, one smallholders, and one on research and innovation. And each of these topics, there's really important progress that can be made, really important discussions that are happening. But transparency, traceability is fundamental. It's an area that so much advance has happened. so many things, so many organizations working really to understand what is occurring up and down supply chains and in each of these forest landscapes. And so with the great work that's going on, I'm delighted that we're going to have a panel hosted by Morgan Gillespie, the Program Director for the Food and Land Use Coalition. So Morgan will be picking up to talk about transparency and introducing the panel she has shortly after a really exciting video that brings together three of the tools that that have been working on across the sort of deforestation risk tool set. So let's run the video and then we can come back to Morgan to then talk us through this first panel.
Companies are being held to high standards of responsibility by customers, investors, and other stakeholders to protect people and nature while ensuring stable commodity supplies. Many companies have set ambitious goals to eradicate deforestation and ecosystem conversion from their supply chains. To meet these goals, companies need a clear blueprint for action. They require accurate supply chain data and business intelligence to assess risk and manage supplier networks. They must also put in place trusted monitoring systems to track and report on progress. Now these goals are in reach. The deforestation risk toolset can help companies act with confidence. This set of three publicly available and integrated resources enables companies to meet market and stakeholder expectations. The toolset offers harmonized sector-wide guidance for companies to follow as they set goals, take action, and demonstrate progress using advanced data and analytics. The accountability framework provides a roadmap for each stage of a company's responsible supply chain journey. Grounded in broad consensus, it helps companies set strong commitments and adopt best practices for implementation. The framework also presents a structured outline for reporting on forest risk commodities, including recommended metrics. Trace follows forest risk commodities from where they are produced to where they are consumed, enabling companies and investors in global consumer markets to identify and assess risk in production regions. The information system is comprehensive, interactive, and customizable. Global Forest Watch Pro allows companies and financial institutions to measure and manage deforestation risks at origin. It translates geospatial data on land use changes into analysis used to identify non-compliance, make informed decisions about risk mitigation strategies, and show impact. As a whole, the deforestation risk toolset provides an easy, affordable, and credible way to set, implement, and report on sustainability commitments. Empower your company to achieve sustainable growth in line with the expectations of customers, investors, and other stakeholders. Connect with us to learn how the deforestation risk toolset can deliver value for your business.
Thank you, Justin, and what a pleasure to be here today and to welcome so many people onto such an excellent call. My name is Morgan Gillespie. I have the great pleasure of hosting a panel for the next 17 minutes or so to discuss this critical issue of transparency and traceability. Now, we all understand how critical both transparency and traceability are to halting deforestation. That video was an excellent reminder of the tools available. They are essential sources of data, of intelligence, really enabling business to identify risk, to measure so that they can better manage, and to demonstrate success. Companies are also able to adjust their strategies with this information so that they can deliver both on our climate, but also our nature ambitions. Now, we have two excellent speakers joining us today. We have Leah Sandberg, who is a PhD scientist and also the global policy an advisor for the Accountability Framework Initiative, which is housed at Rainforest Alliance. And we also have Kevin Rabanovich, who is the Global Vice President of Sustainability at Mars. Now we're gonna listen to them both for about 5 minutes, but audience listening, I'm gonna tee you up now. Please drop your questions into the Q&A. We're gonna have about 7 minutes to hear from you, to ask questions to Leah and to Kevin, to really understand what we can do to drive this initiative forward. So Leah, over to you first. Can you share your thoughts with us? Maybe first a bit of an update on the AFI, the Accountability Framework Initiative, and how it can contribute to transparency and traceability aims and ambitions. What are some of the solutions that you are seeing? And specifically, what do you think the FACT dialogues could do to unlock progress? Leah.
Absolutely. Thanks, Morgan. And thanks, everybody, for hosting this. I'll start a little bit about the Accountability Framework Initiative and what we're up to and the opportunities I see presented here. So the Accountability Framework Initiative is a coalition of currently 26 civil society groups. We're constantly growing, engaged in eliminating deforestation, ecosystem conversion, and human rights abuses from agricultural and forest commodity production and trade. The coalition includes large conservation sustainability organizations, such as TNC, WWF, and WRI, human rights organizations such as SAI, Verite, and the Forest Peoples Program, organizations that provide direct support to companies such as ProForest or Preferred by Nature, and reporting and assessment organizations such as CDP and Global Canopy. So it's a very broad coalition of groups working from all aspects of this problem. The goal of the initiative is to develop and promote standardized, consensus-based definitions, principles, and best practices for deforestation and conversion-free supply chains. The framework is intended to be used by companies at all stages of the supply chain, as well as by financial institutions, investors, policymakers, and other civil society organizations to support a common language and understanding around policy setting, supply chain management, monitoring and verification, and reporting. This includes detailed guidance on what information, what level of supply chain traceability, what sort of disclosure is necessary both for companies to achieve forest-related goals and for other stakeholders to make informed and consistent decisions about purchasing, financing, importing, other actions. The hope is that this standardized approach can both save time not in reinventing the wheel and also create alignment and consistency among the many actors, initiatives, and tools involved in the space, which seems to be growing every day. Crucially, the infrastructure needed to take action to implement these best practices is already in place and up and running in the form of aligned traceability and monitoring tools, such as GFW Pro and Trace, as described in the video we just saw, as well as in the form of aligned indicators and criteria in disclosure systems, such as CDP Forests and the new GRI Agriculture Sector Standard. We're also working to support processes such as the Greenhouse Gas Protocol and the Science-Based Targets Initiative to ensure that forthcoming guidance on land sector emissions also aligns with commonly accepted deforestation and conversion-free approaches. The utility of this sort of holistic standardization effort is becoming increasingly apparent. For example, the framework is being used currently by the Consumer Goods Forum's Forest Positive Coalition, which Kevin will speak to shortly, I'm sure, to guide the development of commodity roadmaps and associated indicators. And by a number of other groups as well, the Global Platform for Sustainable Natural Rubber, using the framework as the basis for policies and guidelines it's developing, the UK Roundtable for Responsible Soya and the European Feed Manufacturers Federation are using the framework to set sourcing guidelines and criteria for their members. So it's really proving to be a very useful and essential standardization tool for creating aligned expectations across this space. A key feature of consensus-based approaches like the AFI, and what I think gets to the heart of the opportunities presented by the FACT dialogue, is that it has the potential to help bridge divides in perspectives, contexts, and even languages between the countries that produce forest risk commodities and those that import them. Even really foundational concepts like what is a forest, what is deforestation, can really hinder policy effectiveness if not aligned. For example, next month, the Economic Community of Central African States is going to meet to consider adopting the Accountability Framework terminology as a reference for policies across its 11 member states. If demand-side companies were to do this, countries were to do the same, it would remove a key barrier toward aligned public policy. And to the focus of this session, common expectations and practices for transparency, traceability, monitoring, and disclosure are really essential to the development of policies that act in synergy with each other as well as the ability to both adhere to and to enforce those policies in an informed way. And while we can provide suggestions for best practice, in the end, it's generally in the hands of governments to create the enabling environment for the information sharing and consistent legal frameworks that support effective decision-making throughout supply chains and across borders. So this dialogue was really timely and essential, and I'm looking forward to seeing it move forward.
Thank you, Leah. That's a fantastic overview and really kind of comprehensive, reminds everyone how comprehensive AFI has really actually become. And you know, at a really simple level, you kind of forget, we all need to speak the same language, right? To understand where we are and where we're going. And AFI has done a really phenomenal job of creating that baseline understanding so that we're all at least talking in the same way about the same concepts at the same time. And it's amazing. Sometimes it amazes me that that hasn't been actually done before. And that we're just kind of now at that point, we're like, oh no, we can all understand what we're saying so that we can really actually accelerate action. Now, Kevin, you know, same questions over to you, but very different perspective, right, from Mars. And I know Mars has done such phenomenal work, particularly on the traceability side of things. So maybe really quickly, you know, an update on your work and how it's contributing to this discussion. What are some of the potential solutions you see as a private sector organization, as a company? And what do you think FAT can do to unlock progress as it relates to transparency and traceability?
Yeah, great. Thanks, Morgan. And thanks to the WEF and TFA team for helping organize this session and put this together. Yeah, maybe I'll say a few words about Mars, but then actually what I mostly like to update and share with the group is the broader work of the CGF Forest Positive Coalition, which Leah had mentioned. So yeah, within Mars, we've done a lot of work on really all of the forest commodities that we have exposure to, which are sort of the classical big four that are talked about, as well as cocoa is sort of the fifth. And you know, we've done a lot of work in a lot of those supply chains, both to better understand our footprint, and then in the leading examples, for example, our work in Palm Positive Program, actually redesign our supply chains to make the whole task of transparency and traceability easier. So with a more simplified supply chain, with shorter, more direct supply, it becomes easier to keep track of all this information. And I had an interesting conversation with someone in our finance team, where they introduced the concept of designing data systems to be auditable. So don't just, you have a data system and now go do an audit on it. Think about how you design a system that will be easier to audit when you want to do an audit. And that idea is something we've really brought into our approach, is designing supply chains that make transparency and traceability easier, as opposed to just trying to stamp it onto whatever supply chains we happen to be operating today. With respect to the CGF Forest Positive Coalition, which Leah mentioned, and certainly a number of participants on the webinar here are part of, I scrolled through the names and saw quite a few familiar names and faces that actually helped contribute to what I'm about to talk about, not least of which the TFA team led by Justin. So what we realized in the companies that are part of the CGF a number of years ago was that, you know, we'd made a commitment as CGF in 2010 to a deforestation resolution. And we'd realized there were a couple things about that we could improve on. So one was we had a very high level ambition. It was kind of vague. There weren't metrics. And it was really just about our supply chains. And what we realized was that wasn't enough to really tackle these issues. And so where we've pivoted to in our new theory of change is really looking not just at our individual supply chains, but at the entirety of the supply of the suppliers that we work with. So looking not just at the volumes I buy from you, but all of the volumes that you transact with all of your customers, and evaluating suppliers' deforestation-based behavior on that basis, not based on individual supply chains. The other two things we've done are pivoted much more to a focus on impact. So it's less about, do you have a policy? Are you certified? And it's more about what's actually happening on the ground. What are the metrics? What are the data? And then the other realization was that even having gone from supply chains to looking at suppliers, in many of these landscapes, the drivers of deforestation aren't limited to an individual commodity. And you actually have to look at a landscape level and broaden out to multiple commodities, or even things that are beyond the commodity space. Urbanization and mining and other factors. And so that led to sort of a landscape engagement approach. And that whole theory of change has been laid out, and we published that. But more specifically, we've captured individual commodity roadmaps, or we've built individual commodity roadmaps to capture that theory of change and translate it into the palm specific version of that or the soy specific version of that. And within those roadmaps, we have KPIs that we're reporting against. And this is where we really get into the transparency and traceability side of things, is we've set up these KPIs so that they are reflective of the theory of change. So we have a coherent flow from a big picture idea to a commodity specific roadmap to individual KPIs. And then companies within the CGF Forest Positive Coalition, and soon other companies as well, are beginning to report against those KPIs publicly, individually as companies, which then enables CGF to aggregate that information and tell stories, but it also enables everyone else to see that information and use it and analyze it and do things with it. And we really think that is sort of the key to driving the change here, is making that more granular information visible and then expanding its use beyond just the coalition. So we're in discussions with a number of other business coalitions like OP2B and others, and also working with groups like the Accountability Framework and Forest 500 and CDP to think about how do we start getting some of these KPIs built into some of these broader reporting platforms, so that, again, in the same way that we're all using the same language on what is a forest, we're all using the same language when we say, what do we mean by traceability? And what do we mean by, you know, has something happened on the ground? So that's really the direction we're pushing. You know, we're very excited about the progress we're making. It is, as maybe my final comment, I'll say, it is fair to realize that because this is a new theory of change and there are some new KPIs, some of our initial reporting is not going to be green across the board, right? If everyone was green across the board, then it wasn't the new theory of change. but it's a journey, and we're very much looking forward to it.
Thank you, Kevin. That was really excellent and exciting and heartening to hear the progress that's being made by the companies. And if it was green across the board, we wouldn't be having these conversations, right? The problem would be solved. And so, you know, that's something that we need to seek to change. We have about 4 minutes left. There's been a few questions that have come up, so I'm going to try to quickly get through a few of them. One of the first one, I think, Leah, is probably for you. Within my organization, I often hear transparency and traceability thrown around as a term, and I'm asked, number one, what the heck do they mean? And number two, how do they differ? And what should come first, right? Is there a sequencing to these things?
Absolutely. Excellent question. They are often used in complicated and sometimes contradictory ways. So we see traceability as the ability to follow products through a supply chain from producer through to a retailer. That is an ongoing process for many companies, depending on where they are at in the supply chain. The accountability framework provides a number of options for how to achieve necessary levels of traceability. How much is enough traceability? For example, we don't always say it's got to go all the way back to the farm. Sometimes we can say it can go to a low-risk jurisdiction. Sometimes we can say it can be verified through certification programs. So it's the requisite level of visibility you have through your supply chain to understand the origin of the product, how it was produced, anything that's happening on the ground where that product came from. Transparency is the sharing of that information with buyers, with investors, with the public, with consumers. And that should be an ongoing process that happens while traceability is being established, improved, and addressed. So that I would say it's very much an iterative process, where as more information is learned about the supply chain and the nature of the products and the attributes of those products, that information should be shared, which is the transparency piece of it, in order to facilitate effective decision-making by other stakeholders.
Fantastic, thanks, Leah. And Kevin, quick last and probably final word from you, just because I'm not sure you mentioned it in your presentation, as a participant in the CGF, which is a huge number of businesses working collaboratively, what would be the ask to the FACT dialogues right now to really help you guys to achieve what you're looking to do?
Yeah, I think in the same way that we are working, and thank you for the question, because I failed to say something that I should have. So in the same way that we are working to expand the private sector participation in our theory of change beyond just the companies in the coalition and our suppliers to other companies, and in the same way that we're also reaching out to the NGO community and the scorecard creators to reach out into those directions, we also have a government engagement work stream within our program, which again, it's the same idea. It's to bring that same theory of change to to policymakers, right? So in the same way that, you know, we as Mars are increasingly evaluating our suppliers on the entirety of their business, not just what they sell to us, there's an opportunity perhaps for policymakers to think in similar ways, is evaluating businesses on the entirety of their behavior and really reinforcing the signal and making it easier for everyone to do what we all know needs to be done for the future. So I think the fact dialogues are an exciting opportunity to further reinforce and build on that theory of change.
Perfect. Thank you, Kevin. I want to thank you again, Kevin and Leah, for that brief but really, really rich panel. I'm going to hand back over to Justin, but before doing so, Justin, I'm going to ask you a question that came up in the Q&A, which was, is there a plan to roll out the deforestation risk toolkit, the Global Forest Watch Probe, Trace, et cetera, to local organizations working with national government? And with that, thank you all. And Justin, back over to you.
Thank you, Morgan. And thank you, Kevin, Leah, for a really, really great panel. We'll try to come back to that, and there's some other questions if some of the panelists want to try and answer them in the type function on Zoom. But I think we've really reinforced this importance of traceability, transparency, and what I want to do now is go back to Simon Sharp, who I tried to introduce earlier. Simon, I know you had some technical difficulties. But from the COP26 team, to really talk about from a government perspective what the UK is trying to do and give us an update as to where these government dialogues are. And having heard some of that traceability transparency talk, then hopefully that gives you some substance as to also what you want from this broader multi-stakeholder community. Thank you, Simon.
Thanks, Justin. Great to see you and great to be part of this group again. And it was really, really helpful to hear that panel discussion just now, which raised quite a few of the same issues that the governments have been talking about. So I think we met last as this group several months ago. So just to say to anyone out there who's new to this FACT, Forest, Agriculture and Commodity Trade Dialogue process, what we're trying to do with this is really bring about strong collaboration between governments that can shift global markets in agricultural commodities towards sustainability in a way that supports development and trade. And our sense is that there's been a huge amount of valuable work on this that's made great progress by governments individually and by companies, by civil society. But what's been lacking is this really strong international collaboration that where there have been good examples, they've often been bilateral and they've not been enough yet to really shift global markets. There's also been quite a lot of unilateral action and sometimes that's very contentious. And as a whole, collectively, as a global community, we've not yet managed to solve this problem. Deforestation rates are still very high by historical standards, and we need them rapidly decreasing. Often in the past, I think European countries, Western countries have been criticized for seeing this issue coming at it as purely one of climate change and protecting biodiversity. Without adequately recognizing the interests of developing countries, smallholder farmers, and those really strong and legitimate interests in development and trade. So what we're trying to do with this is come at the problem in a way that does recognize the importance of all of those interests and works out how can those interests be brought together in a form of coordinated collaborative action that actually does address the problem on a systemic level. So this process began in the autumn of last year, where we held regional meetings in Africa and Asia and Latin America. We were supported by the TFA and other stakeholder networks in doing that. And then in this year, in April, we held a meeting of the ministers of the 20-something, nearly 30 countries in the FACT dialogue to agree the overall direction of travel and the priority areas that we work together on. And they agreed that we should really focus on four areas And in each of those, set up working groups for the governments to get down to details and work with each other on the specifics. So those were trade and markets, transparency and traceability, support to smallholders, and innovation and productivity. So we set up those four working groups just a few months ago. At the same time, we issued a statement that about 20 of the countries agreed, a statement on the principles for collaboration. We thought that was important to get out there quite early in this process as a way of allowing countries to express how they wanted to work together in a spirit of mutual respect, recognizing each other's interests, and with the intention of aligning their policies over the course of time. We thought it was quite significant that the group of countries that did endorse that was a very diverse group. It included some of the major producers like Brazil and Indonesia, and also some of the consumer countries and some that have been very active in international work to protect forests like Norway. So a very diverse group of countries that did come together around those principles, and those will guide our work going forwards. The four working groups, they had their first round of meetings when was it? A month or slightly more ago. And I suppose it's difficult to summarize the complexity of those discussions, but I'll just draw out one or two points. On trade and markets, everybody recognizes this is absolutely central to the problem. And of course, it's also the place where there's the greatest diversity of interests, from countries that really want to go ahead on demanding sustainability of their imports, or those that are prepared to set themselves very high standards for sustainability and production. Those that are concerned about what they might see as protectionist approaches, and those that really feel they may be disadvantaged themselves by not enough other countries moving in the same direction. Despite that diversity of interests, I think what we heard is some convergence of interest around a couple of things. One is the need for policy coherence, that it really would advantage everybody if there's a greater degree of alignment between different countries in what they're expecting and the standards they're trying to meet. And second, the need for a level playing field, so that where there is sustainable production, it is rewarded and not disadvantaged. On transparency and traceability, I think the issues were similar to many of those being discussed just now in the panel. And some governments were saying, look, we need to be really clear. What do we mean by this? What information needs to be shared, by who, to who, for what purpose? Fairly basic. And again, recognition of the value of harmonizing those expectations and those requirements, rather than having an enormous patchwork of different requirements from every player in the market. That I think recognition that transparency and traceability is necessary. At the same time, concerns about how you ensure the costs of meeting those requirements don't fall on those who are least able to bear them. And that's an incredibly important point. And also the point about sovereignty of concern of many governments, and therefore the need to decide what information really does need to be disclosed and shared and what does not. In talking about support to smallholders, not surprisingly, there's a great deal of interest in mobilizing investment to support smallholders. That was probably the central thing. But people also recognize it's not just a problem of the availability of money, it's also a massive logistical challenge. And solving that is really not easy. Some governments have got very innovative programs in that space, and some companies have been doing good work as well. And I think what there was a lot of interest in across the group is identifying those examples of best practice and working out how we scale them up. And fourth, on the innovation and productivity, I think the point was well made that sharing of best practice shouldn't just be sort of north to south. There are also some great examples, for example, in Brazil, of really leading innovation and great potential for south-south cooperation. So we have the second round of these working group meetings beginning next week, and we're hoping to go into more depth on potential areas for cooperation in each of them. And I'm really grateful to Justin and Fabiola and the Multi-Stakeholder Task Force for developing some specific proposals that will be put in front of the governments for discussion. Within the task force, there's a different organization leading the work to bring together ideas in each of the four areas: UNDP on trade and markets, WRI on transparency and traceability, IDH on support to smallholders, and the CGIAR on innovation. And all four of them have begun that process of gathering ideas from the wider community based on the decades of experience that people have, and putting some specific proposals on the tables for governments to look at. So I really expect that we'll use the meetings in the next couple of weeks to discuss those proposals and give feedback to the multi-stakeholder group, saying these are the ideas that we'd really like to see worked up in more depth. Then it's only 4 months to go now until COP26. And so what we hope to do among this group of countries is set out the most important elements of the way forward, the actions that we'll take individually and together over the coming years, and put that together into one joint roadmap that can be released at COP26. That's what we hope to do. And at the same time, of course, take some real steps in that direction, agree some specific measures that governments in this group will take together to go towards those joint shared objectives of protecting the forests while promoting development and trade. So that's where we are. Again, I'm hugely grateful to the Multi-Stakeholder Task Force for their support. There's a wealth of expertise here, and it's really adding quality to the discussions between the governments and giving us all hope that we can do something together that moves us forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Simon. We've got a couple of minutes for questions, and one I'd like to sort of throw back to you. I mean, clearly lots going on, and really helpful to see the trust and the dialogue that is taking place. What's realistic to sort of achieve at Glasgow? You talked about this roadmap, and then what's the prospect look like beyond Glasgow as well, with all the trust and discussion?
Well, I think the thing we're all conscious of is that this is a long game, and we couldn't possibly expect to have all agreed exactly how we'll reorganize global trade so that it meets all of our objectives in the next 4 months. So I think what is realistic to hope for is maybe two things. One is identification of the best existing programs, whether in terms of support to smallholders or in terms of enabling greater transparency, some of the examples we were just hearing about, and commitments to participate in those, support them, fund them, scale them up. I think that is realistic for us to hope for by COP26, because those are things that already have momentum, have already demonstrated some of their value. The second thing is commitments to processes from here that take us further towards where we go. So for example, on traceability and transparency, if governments decide that they would like to have a common agreed set of requirements for that, then they could agree to a process to develop that common set of requirements. And of course, we know that would take time, that would probably take years, but they could agree at COP that that's what they're going to work on together. Again, I think that is realistic to hope for. I can't say that it will be done, because it depends on the independent wishes of nearly 30 different governments, or at least a subset of them. But I think those are realistic things to aim for. We will use our position as presidency, along with our co-chairs, Indonesia, to try and facilitate the kind of discussions that do find that common ground and do land on some specific commitments.
Great, and maybe a last word then. I mean, you've been leading this from the government side. You know, you're integral to the whole of the COP26 planning. But I mean, what gives you hope at this critical time and of kind of that we can really make some progress here, and it can be there's a new dawn for this agenda that so many people have been working on for so long, complex problem.
Well, two things give me hope. One is that when we do hold these discussions among the governments, the spirit is incredibly positive. And I think it's because we have done our best to follow the advice of those who've been in these discussions for a long time in the past, and made sure that we're approaching it in a spirit of equality and partnership and mutual respect, and not in the spirit of rushing to judgment and finger pointing. We know there are real problems to solve. We want to be honest with each other about the difficulties and the differences of opinion, but we can approach that in the right spirit. And as I say, when we do bring the countries together, I feel there's enormous positivity and will to work with each other seriously. We have to earn that trust. We have to work hard to maintain that trust and that level of engagement. But it's there, so that gives me hope. And the second thing is the depth of expertise that there is to draw on in the multi-stakeholder community. That, you know, it's very clear we're not starting from scratch now. Even if you look at a graph of deforestation and it doesn't look very hopeful, throughout all of these years, people have been learning from experience and you know, honing their ideas about how we move forward. When I see the kind of proposals that the multi-stakeholder task force is putting in front of governments, that gives me a lot of hope, because there are high quality ideas here for us to discuss.
Terrific. Well, Simon, thank you for your leadership and for putting this agenda so high in the COP26 process itself. Really helpful to get that sort of overlay, and also really helpful to get the sort of the pieces you're hopeful about as we're going forward. This trust and the through the dialogue that's taking place, and as you say, the depth of expertise that is there. And that's a great segue as we go to this next section of today's discussion, which is a section about how we actually unlock innovation. So often this is a discussion that becomes fractious and fragmented. As Simon said, there's so many great things that are already happening. We heard some of that in the transparency discussion a few moments ago, and it's great to see some of the answers in chat around how something like AFI, a tool that's been developed over several years, is now being applied into specific country settings to really support the type of process that we need. And so one thing that we have come together with is to think about how we can work on innovation and actually really try and upscale some of the best ideas that are out there. And many of you are working on those ideas. And what we want to try and do is see how we can actually bring a new innovation theme or more of an innovation content into this agenda without belittling the challenges and the complexity that sit in the middle of the forest food interface, but really looking to try and bring that same dynamic we see in other areas of the climate discussion, which is about innovation, it's about green jobs, it's about new opportunity. And we want to see what can we do to instill some of that. So we've teamed up with the World Economic Forum's open innovation platform, which is called Uplink, doing all sorts of extremely interesting challenges that you can see online, focused on different of the sustainable development goals. And we're launching today this Tropical Forest Commodities Challenge to really see what some of the best ideas that are out there could be that we could then help spotlight in the run-up to Glasgow and at Glasgow itself. So we'll be highlighting some of those in November. as Simon says, just a few short months away now, but we know how many great things are being worked on. And so this is a challenge that's going to be open just for the next few weeks, but it's going to be something that will probably run on an ongoing basis to try and bring some of these great ideas forward, highlight them in the funding community, highlight them for different governments to see what can be seized on to sort of try and drive some real progress. So we're going to run a short video now. That's the last video we'll have for today's session. And then we've got another great panel straight after that.
Can best be produced in the tropical forests around the world, whether it's Southeast Asia, Africa, or Latin America. If it is not done in a sustainable manner, it's clearing primary forest or secondary forest. And the idea of solutions for this is to make sure that it's done in a sustainable manner so we can produce more with less.
Focus on environmental impact, socioeconomic impact, and where your innovation can scale into a nature-positive food production and even consumption, always keeping in mind the zero deforestation or deforestation-free focus. So you can visualize the trade-offs that exist today that are inhibiting these nature-positive transformations, and from there, bring your excellent solution into this uplink challenge.
So there you have a short overview of the challenge, and I'm delighted that we have got both Kamal from RSPO and Bibi from Eat Better Waik, who are going to be with us now for a short discussion on the Uplink Challenge, why we're doing it, what it's about, what we're hoping to try and achieve with it. But the fundamental question is, what is your big idea? What can we bring into this process you're already working on, or something that actually starts thinking about this in a new way to try and really create some new ways of thinking about this problem and new ways of solving it. And so both Kamal and Bibi, I'm delighted to say, are members of the multi-stakeholder task force that we heard Simon mention. I didn't talk about that in my introduction, but that's about 30 individuals from all over the community, north and south, producers, consumers, NGOs, academics, et cetera, to try and bring a really diverse set of perspectives and feed directly into the government process. And Bibi and Kamal have really been instrumental in this innovation. So I'm going to turn to Bibi first and really talk about you know, why it's particularly important we're trying to bring a sort of youth perspective here, and what you would say to encourage people to come up with ideas that and sort of enter them into this uplink challenge.
Thank you so much, Justin. I hope the connection is good. It's been raining here a lot, very characteristic from a tropical country here in Guatemala. So hope the connection stands still. Well, I first of all, thank you so much for considering me in the FACT dialogue and today here, and really listening to from the start of the session. It's just so encouraging. I don't know, it lifts my spirits up. It's I'm very positive, not only nature positive, but we're really moving to another point, a turning point. And I think this is where youth come in to bring this this energy, where we see that the generations that have been working on this topic before us are really moving forward in a mindset shift and really action oriented to a more responsible and sustainable way. And I believe also being here as well is how youth are included in these conversations and wanting to move forward in a collaborative way to the future that we want. Besides, you go on Uplink right now. I'm here. You need to create a profile. I have already a profile. You have 43 days until you submit your solution. Just very comprehensible, and it's a very easy way for you to bring your ideas in a very simple manner as well. And you need to have your thoughts clear of how this combines with the objectives. And just bring it on, and we want to know more from you guys.
Great. Well, BB, thank you, and your internet's great. If it's any consolation, my internet is also dropping in and out today. So, but really great, and obviously youth doing so much in the climate movement overall, and we know that the forest agenda, the deforestation agenda, is becoming increasingly important for youth as well, and great. Thank you for your work in Guatemala and for your support to the FACT dialogue. I'm going to turn to you, Kamal. And where do you think some of these breakthrough ideas, breakthrough solutions are going to come from?
Yeah, I think I'm delighted to be here and being a part of the solution. We have launched several initiatives in India, China, and also in Singapore and some of the other countries called Youth for Sustainability or the Know Your Farm campaign. So there has been enough traction already. And the point now is how can that be scaled up to build more consensus? And some of the things that we would like to see in this challenge, say, how can you be a part of the solution and not the problem? In which case, you're not just highlighting that or criticizing governments and companies and multinationals, but what are you willing to do as a young person of this world and a global citizen? Can you submit ideas for something as big as this, which is stopping deforestation in the tropical regions around the world? So my call to action for anyone watching this or later on is be a part of the solution. And there is a theme that we use for a lot of work called action before reaction. So are you willing to be that proactive to submit ideas now so that your generation or the next generation and even this generation has more access to forest and the livelihood that it supports? And the other thing is to use the power of the vote and the wallet. So any ideas would be most welcome if you can build a campaign to use the power of your vote. And if you're an 18-year-old person around the world, you should be voting. That's the first thing. To elect governments and politicians who are supporting the sustainability agenda. And the second is the power of your wallet. So if you make a decision for your shopping online or offline, how can you build a campaign? And we have seen some success stories and some lighthouses in our part of the world, in Asia, in which such campaigns have been built. So we are looking and very excited about seeing the breakthrough ideas that will improve that consumer awareness and that will provide the assurance to consumers around the world that if they buy something from the shelf, if they buy something online, that it has not caused deforestation. So ideas about how can we mainstream deforestation-free supply chains, ideas about how can millions of consumers use their vote and wallet for all the right reasons for sustainability. So that would be what we are excited to look for.
Super. So what I'm hearing from both of you is really is really about engaging a much broader community, engaging younger people, engaging consumers, so not just the usual actors, but how do we actually just bring many more ideas into this? So, you know, one final thought from both of you about what gives you some hope about where we are and how we can turn the corner on commodity-driven deforestation. Phoebe first.
Well, you guys give me hope. All of here, the audience, the panelists as well, and really opening opportunities for others to express what they're thinking in a way that you can write it down here in this submission for the Tropical Forest Commodity Challenge. It's just being that open and being aware of others that maybe their voices, but can be a bit not listened. So this is the opportunity to really make it worthwhile and even bring your wild ideas that you think are crazy, but they're actually not. And that's the most creative part of it, of really being involved in solutions that are the future that we need, right? And it needs to come now. Right. So thank you.
Thank you, Bibi. Kamal.
Well, I will keep it very real. What gives me hope is my own experience of working with the youth in India, China, Indonesia, Malaysia, and Singapore. And I name these countries because hundreds of volunteers have joined Youth for Sustainability clubs and similar initiatives to be the change they want to see. So my hope is with the youth who are the solution, and they have submitted so many ideas to us till date. And now we'll encourage them to submit ideas for the World Economic Forum Opening Challenge as well. So youth is the hope, but we should not be restricted to just looking at youth for solutions. I think the previous generation that has caused the problems directly or indirectly also have the responsibility to provide solutions. So my call to action is, if you have ever criticized any government, multinationals or NGOs for not doing enough, this is your chance to provide the solution and not just criticize.
Excellent. Two wonderful spokespeople to get this Tropical Forest Commodities Challenge underway. And I couldn't agree more. Youth, I'm energized just listening to the two of you sort of bring your passion to this. So thank you for everything you're doing and for joining us today. And again, this call, this is open to everybody. So yes, let's engage new people, but the NGOs on the call, the companies on the call, you're doing innovative things, right? Let's bring it, let's spotlight kind of where and what is happening, because as Simon said, there is an awful lot happening, but it's not always joined up. And as the opening video said, it's actually about the collective action where we're going to make progress. So really terrific. One area we know we need to make progress is smallholders. And in fact, it's increasingly clear from the data that a lot of the deforestation, a lot of the challenges really sit at this interface of where poverty and food production come together in the forest frontiers. This smallholder issue, as Simon said, is one that is central to what almost each of the forest countries is asking in the FACT dialogues as well. And so IDH is helping coordinate some of this work now within FACT as part of the task force. Fitrin Andriansia is a leader in Southeast Asia that needs no introduction, is doing extraordinary work with IDH there. I'll let you introduce the panel, really looking forward to listening to your thoughts on what we can all be doing to really drive now more engagement, more support to smallholders. So Fitrin, thanks for being here, across to you.
Thank you so much, Justin. Delighted to be here. Evening, afternoon, and morning to all of you. As Justin mentions, my name is Fitrin Adiansha. Currently, I'm the Global Envoy for Nature-Based Solutions with IDH. Day-to-day, also, I'm directing IDH operations in Indonesia and Malaysia. I believe what Justin has mentioned, as well as earlier Simon has mentioned, the importance of smallholders issues to be addressed. And I think in the context of FACT dialogue or multi-stakeholder dialogue and also government to government dialogue, there are numbers of key elements that we need to address. We need to provide solutions when it comes to smallholders challenges or issues. The first one, of course, how can we provide support to smallholders, not necessarily only to address deforestation, but even a basic support like providing support for addressing enabling environment that includes land legality, farmers organization strengthening, and what have you. And of course, can we also develop a good structure to help smallholders to get access to finance, to get access to the market, and of course, to get access to technology. So with that, I'm so honored to facilitate this discussion because we have two great panelists. The first one, we got Fabiola Munoz from Peru. Just to remind you, Fabiola is the coordinator for Peruvian Coalition for Sustainable Productions. She will be speaking in Spanish, if I'm not mistaken. So for those that need Spanish translations, you can check in the interpretations icon down at the Zoom line over there, so you can switch that. And after that, Victoria Wiafi from West and Central Africa Regional Director for P4F also would like to share their thoughts related to potential solutions, update on their work, and also how they can contribute further. Especially also Fabiola and Victoria, you may want also to explore questions and also challenges. What could FAC as a dialogue and also platform can do to unlock certain progresses? So with that, 5 minutes to each of you. Over to you, Fabiola.
Muchísimas gracias. Buenos días con todos, con todas. Mi nombre es Fabiola Muñoz, como ya lo mencionaron. Muchísimas gracias a Tropical Forest Alliance por la oportunidad. Como dijo Simon, yo coordino junto con Justin esta idea del Multi-Stakeholder Task Force para el FAC Dialogue. Y es un placer poder conversar con ustedes. En Perú tenemos lo que se llama la Coalición por una Producción Sostenible, que yo coordino, y es un espacio en el que podríamos decir que estamos un poco locos, porque estamos tratando de hacer que todos los actores del gobierno, de las empresas, los pequeños productores, los grandes, los que exportan, se pongan de acuerdo. Y el reto mayor es ser capaces de dialogar. Y dialogar implica necesitar también aplicar la confianza. O sea, no puedes tener un diálogo transparente, abierto, si no confías en el otro, pero si no respetas al otro. Y ese es quizás uno de los elementos más importantes en el reto que tenemos cuando trabajamos con pequeños. Porque creemos a veces que los pequeños o los pueblos indígenas no tienen nada que aportarnos. Y lo cierto es que nos equivocamos. Tienen muchísimo que aportarnos. Y nosotros podemos aprender mucho, las empresas pueden aprender, los gobiernos pueden aprender, pero también los pequeños pueden aprender. Sin embargo, para eso tenemos que tener, y creo que lo han mencionado también ahora, un entendimiento común. Cuando, imagínense, ¿no? Si aquí en este espacio tenemos que tener claridad sobre lo que significa transparencia y trazabilidad, imagínense lo que significa para los pequeños o para los pueblos indígenas que tienen otra visión. El diálogo tiene que ser un diálogo intercultural también. Y tenemos que ser capaces de ponernos en el lugar del otro, con respeto, con consideración, con igualdad, ¿no? Tenemos diferencias, por supuesto que sí, pero tenemos que sentirnos en el mismo nivel para trabajar todos juntos. Y eso implica reducir justamente la asimetría, la diferencia de acceso a información, de acceso a tecnología, de oportunidades de conectividad. La Coalición por una Producción Sostenible es un espacio donde tratamos justamente de pensar no solamente en el productor y en el producto, sino en el territorio, de aplicar una visión de gestión integral del territorio. Porque los pequeños productores, además, son diversos y no tienen un solo producto. Aquí en el Perú, un pequeño productor puede tener cacao, pero también puede tener productos forestales, maderables o no maderables. Y ello implica que tenemos que estar preparados para la diversidad. No siempre entendemos eso cuando conversamos con los pequeños. No siempre entendemos la cosmovisión y la forma como los pueblos indígenas se conectan con la naturaleza y con el territorio. Y ellos no siempre van a entender cuáles son los drivers de los mercados. Entonces necesitamos dialogar para poder entendernos con transparencia. Y los retos que tenemos no son pequeños. En la coalición, por ejemplo, hemos logrado hacer una cosa que se llama el acuerdo de cacao, bosques y diversidad. ¿Qué implica esto? El gobierno tiene la tarea de armar un plan nacional de cacao, y esa es una herramienta muy importante que toma su tiempo, igual que para palma, igual que para café, igual que para muchos otros productos. Pero los acuerdos como estos hacen que los actores de todos los niveles, gobiernos regionales, el gobierno nacional, también los productores, los empresarios, los exportadores, nos pongamos de acuerdo en ciertas cosas básicas. Y en esas cosas básicas, en las que podemos irnos poniendo de acuerdo, podemos ir avanzando. Y con ese avance, finalmente, damos insumos para las otras herramientas. Y solo para terminar, porque ya estoy en el tiempo, lo último que quiero decirles es que necesitamos incrementar la ambición y el sentido de urgencia. Todos y todas somos imprescindibles en esta tarea. No importa en el nivel en el que nos encontremos, ni en el lugar en el que nos encontremos. Si no sumamos el esfuerzo colectivo, todos perdemos. Gracias.
Gracias, Fabiola. Thank you so much. I think you put emphasis on very important elements, dialogue that can lead to agreement and, of course, building trust. That's quite important to get in touch and also having that kind of issues to be addressed related to indigenous people as well as smallholders. With this also, I would like to give the floor to Victoria. I hope the connections from your end is quite okay. Victoria, over to you, 5 minutes. Victoria, we cannot hear you. Can someone ask Victoria whether she can unmute herself or? Victoria. Can you hear me? Hello? Well, maybe while waiting for Victoria to jump in, I think I have questions to Fabiola, and hopefully you can also answer. I mean, to get that kind of understanding with smallholders and to build that trust, you need to be perceived that you are part of the groups, part of the indigenous people or smallholders. How can actors from outside, like buyers, investors, and even government to get engaged in that kind of dialogue, Fabiola, and discussing difficult issues, including finance, market, like you just mentioned, because of different perceptions? What would be the strategy from your end? Thank you, Fabiola.
La sobrevivencia. O sea, yo creo que lo que tenemos que mostrar es que si no lo hacemos, si no tomamos la oportunidad, no vamos a sobrevivir, ni los grandes, ni los pequeños, ni los gobiernos, ni nadie, ¿no? O sea, tenemos que entender que, por ejemplo, en el Perú, nosotros somos un país megadiverso, ¿no? La cantidad de emisiones que generamos son chiquititas, realmente pequeñas, pero el impacto que podemos tener, la vulnerabilidad que tenemos como país por el cambio climático es enorme. Y la deforestación es algo que tiene que convertirse en parte de la agenda de cada uno, de cada una. O sea, no podemos seguir perdiendo ecosistemas, biodiversidad, seguridad alimentaria, territorios indígenas, capital natural. Eso es algo que afecta a toda la sociedad, no solamente a los que viven ahí. Entonces, un elemento que es central es cómo acercamos, ¿no?, estas ideas a la vida cotidiana de las personas. Y entonces eso quiere decir que cuando yo compro un producto, como por ejemplo esto, es una miel de castaña, ¿no? Es un producto forestal de los bosques de mi país. Como compradora necesito estar informada. Necesito saber si ese producto tiene un origen que deforesta o no deforesta. Pero mientras yo como consumidora no exija esa información, es probable que la empresa no me la dé. Y ahí entra también la regulación del gobierno. Pero ¿cómo voy a saber yo esto o este tipo de cosas si tenemos problemas, especialmente con los pequeños, para que puedan acceder a espacios de información, de diálogo? Miren hoy día, ¿no? O sea, la conectividad es una de las grandes barreras que tenemos. Victoria se prepara, Victoria quiere estar aquí, Victoria quiere compartir con nosotros y tiene problemas de conectividad. Imaginemos, ¿no es cierto?, un indígena chipivo de selva central en el Perú, ¿cómo se va a conectar? Entonces tenemos que pensar no cómo él se va a conectar, sino cómo nosotros tenemos que conectarlo o conectarla. Ese es el otro tema también, ser conscientes de las brechas de género que tenemos, por ejemplo. Las mujeres, las poblaciones indígenas, son las más vulnerables. ¿Qué estamos haciendo para cerrar esas brechas? Y eso es parte de lo que tenemos que pensar. Pero la única manera de hacerlo posible es si entendemos que el otro tiene valor, que el otro, que la otra, a mí me añade valor. Entonces ahí sí hago todo mi esfuerzo para lograr cruzar esas barreras, cerrar esas brechas. Esa es la forma que hemos encontrado en la coalición y la que estamos tratando de impulsar, ¿no?
Thank you, Fabiola. I think I've seen Victoria now. Victoria, can you hear me?
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes, excellent. Yes. So, okay. Fortunately, maybe you have less than 5 minutes to share your thoughts or experience or models when it comes to smallholders and what sort of potential solutions that you reckon can be shared here, and also what sort of ideas that you think FAC can do help further to unlock progress. Victoria, over to you.
Thank you. And apologies for that hiccup. So I'm really excited to be part of this panel. We all know that smallholders are really vital to the production of global commodities, including cocoa, oil palm, et cetera. Yet they are the most challenged within the value chains in producer countries, resulting in food security, deforestation, social and economic challenges. So just to say a bit about P4F, Partnership for Forests, is a UK government funded global program. We've been operating for the past 5 years, mainly focused in creating public-private partnerships in and around forests with smallholders and companies to develop regenerative business models to make the market ready and commercially viable. Our main aim is to unlock investment into sustainable land use and lead to social and environmental benefits. I am based in Ghana in Western Central Africa, and our main focus has been to contribute to greening and transforming the major commodity supply chain that is driving deforestation, and that is cocoa, oil palm, and timber. And these are all key commodities under the FACT campaign. We have supported enabling conditions like the Cocoa and Forest Initiative and the African Palm Oil Initiatives, and also cocoa companies in partnerships with smallholders. Just to highlight four important areas that I see as areas of support under the smallholder initiative. So one is improving security and access to land. We all know that land tenure is a really big challenge in Africa. About majority of the, about 90% actually of smallholders do not have formal land rights. And the customary land tenure system is the norm in countries in Sierra Leone, Liberia, and Ghana. As part of the work that we've done in P4F in the cocoa and oil palm sector is to support these smallholders to register their lands and also sign agreement with landowners and chiefs for those who are migrant farmers to secure their farms. In cocoa, when you put your cocoa under rehabilitation, there's a risk that you lose the farm. So therefore, most farmers prefer to continue with unsustainable production, low yields, and rather expand into forest areas. So this is one area where the project has been supported. I think it's important for government to secure land rights for these farmers. The next area is access to finance. So it's important to come up with identified structures and mechanisms to deliver low-cost patient capital for smallholder farmers. Currently, less than 4% of commercial banks lend to agriculture, with smallholders being even in a more difficult situation. Access to finance is, less than 10%. The reasons these financial institutions have raised relate to, one, the small size of the farms, the remoteness of the farms, and the lag between investment and expected revenues when you're dealing with tree crops like cocoa and oil palm, and they need to have moratorium in place, and the high transaction cost. So there are a number of things happening in Ghana. So one is that the cocoa board under the Cocoa and Forest Initiative is rolling out a cocoa management system. And this is essentially a comprehensive integrated farmer database to link farmers with LBCs, licensed buying companies, and service providers and import and banks in order to ease that financial inclusion challenge. Additionally, there's a need for a mix of both grants and low interest patient capital, and P4F in Western and Central Africa, we're working with the cocoa companies to figure out cocoa landscape finance mechanism to deliver low carbon deforestation free cocoa within some targeted hotspot intervention areas.
Victoria, yeah. Unfortunately, we are running out of time because we need to wrap up. So sorry for this, but I think you can add some of the explanations or elements that you mentioned in the Q&A or chat, because I think there are some questions that are quite related to your explanations. I think I have seen some questions related to land tenure. You mentioned that access to securing the land would be so crucial, and also access to finance, access to market as well. So again, my apologies, Victoria. But I need to move to Justin, going back again to him. And Justin, probably also you and perhaps other colleagues from TFA can answer some of the questions that are provided to TFA directly regarding the process. With that, I would like to say thank you so much. Gracias, Fabiola. And also thank you so much, Victoria. Hope to see you soon because I've learned so much. Over to you, Justin.
Thank you, Fitrian, and great panel. Thank you, Fabiola, and Victoria as well. And I think, as the discussion showed, and as we're seeing now with the some of the questions arriving in the Q&A, yeah, this is nothing but this is to provide an overview of lots of what's happening. And so, yeah, we're not going to be able to be comprehensive today in covering everything that's going on, nor can the FACT process itself cover everything that is there. I have two last things to do. I'll try and answer some of the questions in a second, but the first is really where and how the FACT dialogue is going to be starting to push businesses, and what and where we're wanting businesses to be making commitments in the run-up to Glasgow. There's a lot of questions about that, and this has been distilled to five asks for business. The first is increased transparency and traceability. We've had a decade of commitments. Now we need a decade of action. How are we going to measure that action through traceability, transparency? I think what Kevin Rabinovich laid out earlier from Mars and the Consumer Goods Forum starts to set the standard of what expectations will be for businesses around how we're tracking progress in these crucial years ahead. The second, this smallholder issue, which we've just touched on in the very smallest of ways with the last excellent panel. Yeah, how can we start to work with smallholders and really find ways of supporting them? This complex set of issues around tenure, around finance, around kind of their role in the landscapes from which these commodities are sourced. I think these social issues are going to really come to the fore, and the expectation on businesses to do more for that is also going to be crucial going forward. So how and where can they support smallholders and others might, you know. So the third is to endorse. Simon talked about the principles that have already been signed up to by government and a roadmap or roadmaps that will be agreed by the various governments that are part of the and leading the dialogue. And we will be wanting businesses and other organizations, all of you on the call, to be offering your support and endorsement for the direction this is taking. The fourth is to be advocating, increasingly important for businesses to be lending their voice to actually constructive policy that will enable some shifts. There's again some chat in the Q&A about very specific forms of legislation. I think one in particular in Brazil, how can we get businesses to align their voice behind positive progress? And the last on the innovate side, yeah, we want businesses to also be bringing innovative solutions forward. They invest millions of dollars into innovation on their products, on their marketing. How can they invest in innovation to help solve some of these challenges? So that's some of what we're hoping for from business. And we just wanted to share that, as we know there are many businesses on the call and many of you work with businesses. So look and where can we push businesses to move things forward for the FACT process. The last slide we have, and really this is moving now in the last 5 minutes of this great call or great interventions from so many people involved, is what the opportunity is. I just saw a question about where the link is for an idea on the Tropical Forest Commodity Challenge. That link is here. We'll be sharing that link out more broadly. Maybe one of my colleagues could also just put it in chat so that it's there for everybody on the call, so that you've got the URL to access the uplink challenge. But really to say, yeah, this is a crucial moment for our forests, for the people in our forests, for the smallholders working in commodity supply chains all around the world. And the unique space that the FACT process is creating is, we think, a real opportunity to advance this agenda in a way that we've not been able to make some of the breakthroughs that we know is needed in the last decade. So many great things are happening, so many great initiatives, but now's the chance to join some of it up. Now's the chance to unleash the collective action that we know is going to be necessary to drive transformation as we go forward. We know governments are leading, and we as the multi-stakeholder community need to look at how we can lean in and how we can support and drive the transformation that is there. We've talked about the uplink challenge, and I see that a link has just been posted in the chat, so you will have that. There is also a collaboration portal online. Again, if you could put that link in chat, that would be really helpful, team. But the collaboration portal is a chance for you to put in some of the best ideas, the white papers, the projects, the videos you've got of really where are good things happening that can all be part of this sort of positive repository of opportunity to move things forward. And the idea is we want to get more people involved. We want to encourage more engagement. But just to acknowledge, I think there's a number of comments in the chat. We're not doing enough to engage more Indigenous people. The connectivity issues that Fabiola just talked to, as Victoria was struggling with her her connection? How can we ensure inclusivity in a world where it's so desperate and things like internet access, let alone language barriers, you know, make all of this difficult? So from the TFA side, we are doing our best. We are feeding up into the government process. We are feeding up kind of where some of those priorities are. And that again is where we would encourage you to be entering some of the best ideas, the best opportunities into this collaboration portal. Send us your own ideas. I see that the comments from Tom and the Forest Peoples Program, yeah, and send us ideas of what more can be done. But let's also bear in mind, this is not, we always try and solve everything. And this is actually on the commodities agenda. How can we really solve that? So let's get specific about the issues that Indigenous people and rights owners need to help to be resolved that could be solved in this fact dialogue, rather than think we can solve everything in each and every one of these spaces. So let's get really specific about that. Let's come forward with where the best ideas are, and let's work together as a community to really try and shift the dynamics around forests and around agriculture over this next decade, because we know the consequences if we are not able to turn the tide. We think FACT is a chance, as I've just said, and we want to get your best ideas into this. And so this is an opportunity. I hope this has been a helpful update for everybody. And we look forward to continuing the dialogue. Give us feedback on whether this format has been helpful or whether there's other ideas on how you would like to be informed of this. But thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you to all the panelists. Thank you to the members of the task force. Thank you to the Uplink team and the launch of the Tropical Forest Commodity Challenge today. And really, let's figure out what we can get done in the run-up to Glasgow and how we set the stage for a really transformative decade ahead. Thank you all. Thanks for the work you're each doing on this topic. And we look forward to connecting again very, very soon. Goodbye for now.